Good morning. It's good to be here. Man, what has God got for us today? What a great question that is, right? Anybody need an espresso? What has God got for us today? I've been asking God all week, Lord, what do you have for us on Sunday? And I tell you, it just feels like I'm going on overload with things that God wants to talk about today. And I'm expectant that all of us have an opportunity today, right where we're at, for God to meet us right there, to speak to us personally and say something that transforms us. It's a great word, transform, isn't it? To where something or better someone on the inside changes from there the things on the outside. Transformation, man. I mean, the walk with Jesus is one huge metamorphosis, isn't it? Unless, of course, you don't know Jesus yet and you're clueless why you think you're in a science class at church. But once you know Jesus and he changes you, it's incredible. You become a disciple. See, that's our real career. It's not the degree on your wall what it says. Man, it's that you're a disciple of the Lord Jesus Christ. There is no greater honor, no higher calling than to be a disciple, a follower of Jesus. Man, it was enough for Peter to say, wow, the nets are full. I could franchise. This could be incredible. Man, I'm leaving all of it because I count it as loss compared to the gain of following. Not the gain of heaven, the gain of just following Jesus. I mean, even if there was no heaven after we die, it would be worth it just to walk with Jesus on earth. For real. I mean, I got more joy about being his son today than going to heaven tomorrow. I mean, I'm looking forward to heaven, don't get me wrong. But the joy of walking with Jesus today, it doesn't get any better. And if you don't have that today, man, I just pray that your heart would open even right now. That rather than getting bitter or critical or pointing the finger or saying, I'm just here because it's mom's day, you know, that you realize it's providence that you're here, man, that God has a word for you. And you're like, you and him are the only ones in the room. You ever had moments like that with God? It's just, you just go, it's just you and me here, Lord. It's freaking me out. What I want to know is who called this guy on the stage and told him everything about me, because this isn't right. My mail's getting red. I hear that all the time. Do you hear that all the time when you talk to people? Like, wait a minute, who told you this? Oh, I didn't know anything. I was just praying for you. I didn't know. No one told me anything. That's the Holy Spirit, right? That's one of the coolest things about being a disciple. See, I'm totally off any notes or plans this morning, but that's okay, right? Is it okay if I like just like all over the place this morning, but we just kind of like go, hey, God, what do you have, right? You know? I mean, there's a few things I know I'm very clear that God wants to be surgical about this morning, but I'm expectant of some crazy right and left turns of like, Lord, what are you going to do? Because, you know, the life of a disciple is not a life of planning center. I mean, I know we like planning center. We like daytimers. We like, you know why we like that? Because we love the illusion of being in control. And we feel by being in control, and I'm speaking to you with administrative gifts. The creatives go, what's the schedule? But, you know, it's like, you know, you take your daytimer away from an administrative person, you know, that's like sacrilegious. You don't do that, right? But we all have control issues. They just manifest in different ways. But the whole thing with wanting a plan is we go, I want the illusion of control. And you ready for even a deeper sting? You ready to get jabbed here? Ready? And the reason we want that is because we want to make sure that we look good. I know it's not what we say. What we say is, no, that's not it, Pastor. I want to be responsible. Let my yes be yes. No, well, that's what you're saying, but it might not be all that. It also could be you want to look good. You want to be appreciated because somehow your identity in Jesus is not enough. Is it enough for you? I mean, after all, if I have God telling me through his son who I am, why do I need anybody to say anything else about me? Amen? I mean, that's good, right? I mean, if I really get that, then I'm okay with this, what, 5,000 and you're telling me to feed them? Okay, Lord. All right. You got to do something. What? Walk on water? It makes no sense, Lord, but okay, you're going to have to do something. Die, and you'll bring me back to life? Die to all my rights? But man, everyone will take advantage of me then, and then what'll happen? God, you're going to have to do something. Such is the life of a disciple. And when Jesus said this huge two-letter word, you know, go, right? He wasn't saying go with a whole mapped out plan and a bank full of money and a big army around you. He just said, oh, and by the way, be sure of this, I'll be with you. That's supposed to be enough. In other words, even if our spouse, our children, our job, our boss, our denomination, our spiritual mentors, even if all forsake and disappoint, and they all will, that you're with me is enough, God. It's enough. How do you know? How do you know you really believe that, right? That's the thing. It's easy to say, amen, amen. But how do you know? Unless, of course, God takes you up on a mountain with hundreds of other people and says, I'm about to leave. I'm about to ascend to the clouds and I want you to go. Oh man, you know the Great Commission. We've been reading it every week. Can we read it again? It's good, right? It's pretty relevant to our lives. Matthew, oh, stand to your feet, saints. Matthew 28, verse 18, Jesus came and told his disciples, and let's read it together. I have been given all authority in heaven and on earth. Therefore, go and make disciples of all nations, baptizing them in the name of the Father and the Son and the Holy Spirit. Teach these new disciples to obey all the commandments I have given you. And be sure of this, I am with you always, even to the end of the age. Lord, thank you for the privilege. Thank you for the honor. God, that you would call us, that you would choose us, God, that you would give us authority, God, and you would give us power, God, and you would give us the promise of your presence. Nothing better, nothing better, Lord. God, we want to be quick to respond to you. So where there's any blockage, God, we call that down this morning in Jesus' name. We welcome you, Holy Spirit, to speak clearly to the bride of Christ and the skeptics alike in this place. Nothing is too difficult for you, God. You can take the hardest heart of stone and make it so soft and pliable in your presence, Lord, in your hand. So we welcome you to do that, God. God, do miracles. You're the same yesterday, today, and tomorrow, God. We believe that. Not because of circumstances, because you say so. We believe it, Lord. Have your way in this place. In Jesus' name we pray, and everybody shouted, amen, amen. Amen. Have a seat. Oh, man. So, the Great Commission. An incredible blueprint and mission statement for you and I. I don't know about you guys, but for me, man, the Holy Ghost has been raising the bar for me in the concept of what it means to be disciplined in my following of Jesus. To be sold out to whatever he wants, whenever he wants, and however he wants it, as crazy, as uncomfortable, and as costly to my dignity that it might be. It's so comforting to know that when he sends us out, he says, hey, I'm going to give you this. I'm going to give you authority. In other words, dominion. When you go out, your world's not going to rule over you. You're going to rule over your world. Do you hear that? He sends us out like sheep among wolves, but like the first Adam, the second Adam said, I'm giving you dominion, authority. But what good, as we talked about last week, is authority without power? It's like I can have my keys to the car and my name on the title, but if I have no money for gas in the car, I ain't going nowhere. So authority, you need power with that authority. But he says, but know this, wherever you go, I'm gonna be right there by your side. You're not gonna see me like Philip needed to see. You're gonna be more blessed by not seeing and believing with my presence with you. And you'll know you're a disciple when you walk in this type of authority. It doesn't come from an Ivy League education or a high IQ. It comes from the presence of a divine God living inside of you. And I don't care if you're a doctor, a brain surgeon, or a stinky fisherman. Man, if God shows up, you're walking in authority and power, and his presence is right there with you, man. Cloud by day, fire by night. But the difference is he's inside you, not above you, right there. Right? And how you know that you're walking in these things, he says, if you're really a disciple, two things are going to happen. One, you're going to reproduce, right? In other words, there's going to be spiritual babies happening all around you. I went to a wedding yesterday, and some of you know Thomas and Aaron from the Young Adults Ministry, and they got married. They got engaged 3 months ago, and they're married tonight. They're heading to Hawaii. It's a nice vacation, right? And Thomas is like, we're having babies right away. For real. Like, he ain't waiting. Because a lot of the young folks are asking, because the thing is today, like, well, I'm going to get married, but we're going to wait a while. And Kathy and I did not wait at all. Matter of fact, 3 months was the time after we were married, she was pregnant, and I kept her that way. By the way, you look beautiful this morning. I know she does, right? I know. Was that too corny for you? I'm sorry. Yeah, you love that. Okay, some of you love it, some of you hate it, whatever. But it was like, we're just like, we want to have kids, man. And it's so cool when you have kids, right? Because don't you love walking them and saying, oh, you know, it's kind of like Vinny and Allie, little Ivy. Is she like adorable? Right? She's got that smirky, cute smile, right? Right? That Allie's got, and she's got Vinny's ears. Adorable. Adorable, right? There's just so many things that you love. I'm sitting there at the wedding holding Ivy. It's like, oh my gosh, I feel like I'm embracing like Vinny and Allie at the same time, but better. she's adorable, you know, incredible, spiritual. I mean, when you're a real disciple, you reproduce. That's one of the big points of genealogy in Matthew 1. So-and-so begot so-and-so, so-and-so begot so-and-so. You should begot so-and-so. Paul had a spiritual son. What was his name? Timothy, making disciples, man. Reproducing. You know that. See, Christianity is not about something to serve you. It's really more to transform you, change you. Because boy, we need change. All the spouses say amen, right? But it's to duplicate you. God's wanting more and more sons under the first order of his son, Jesus Christ, amen? And he wants to reproduce that through you. And what's going on is now the disciples are going out. It's exactly what's about to happen. So Jesus says, when you go out with these new disciples, I want you to teach them to obey everything I've commanded. In other words, it's not the fire insurance card that we get with the prayer that we pray. It's a relationship. It's a change. It's a metamorphosis. And the byproduct should be a love to obey. It's kind of like when you get married. I promise you that Thomas is not going to be in Hawaii going, I love you, Aaron, but man, there's some real beauty queens over there. Can we take a time out on the marriage? Uh-uh. No, it's a joy to obey the covenant. It's a privilege. It's like, I don't want anybody else. That's the way it's supposed to be. You know, we're not supposed to like be getting up and go, oh, doggone it, I got to just worship God alone, really? I don't know, man, but I like to worship Haagen-Dazs. I really do. And I like to worship video games, and I like to worship, you know, and put other things. But no, man, when you're in love with God, it's just like, oh my gosh, all you want to do is obey. And Jesus, it's kind of like an x-ray. When you start putting out there, these are the commands to obey, that freaks a lot of people out when they hear to be a disciple means you need to be obedient. But rarely to hear somebody getting married and go, it really freaks me out. I got to be monogamous in this thing. I mean, that's where you run from the altar, amen? You know, it's kind of like someone being born again, like, oh, I want to be monogamous. I want to be like him. That's the whole point. I want people to mistake me for Jesus. Like, you know, you act like Jesus. You talk like Jesus. Oh, it makes sense. You're a Christian, right? What did Jesus mean, obey my commandments? I mean, some people believe it's a lot. I was talking to Pastor Norm about this last night, and he's got this outline that goes through like the Beatitudes in Matthew and going through the things he talked about that really were pictures of the fulfillment of the law, and talks about, you know, pictures of the kingdom of God, the present kingdom, the coming kingdom. The picture of Matthew 10 with the commission, how they went out in trusting God. Signs of the times, Matthew 24. You know, he's saying, command my disciples. I want them to understand all these things, you see. See, when someone's born again, speaking of signs, a real sign is you hunger for direction. You want to know the will of God. It's kind of like when a baby's born, two things you look for. You look for its mouth to open and noise come out, and then you're going, take it to mommy to eat. Because if it's making no noise and it's not eating, well, then we're somewhat concerned, right? And so when you become a disciple, there's like this appetite that you have for God's word that didn't exist before. I mean, I love the scripture, and you guys know this so well, but I'm on, as you know, many of you, I'm on an Amplified Bible kick lately. So let me read this out of the Amplified in 2 Timothy 2. It says, study and do your best to present yourself to God, approved, a workman tested by trial, who has no reason to be ashamed, accurately handling and skillfully teaching the word of truth. Man, when I got born again, the first thing I wanted to do was read the Bible. I mean, before that, I would rather watch the clock tick, counting seconds down, than read the Bible. But when I was born again, it was like, oh my gosh, this is so personal. And I would open up everything, and it felt like this was just one big love letter to me. Stuff that I'd read before that was just Greek and Hebrew, and now I'm going, oh man, this is a love letter. This is like God talking to me. Can I share an amazing scripture with you? Turn in your Bibles. You got a Bible? You got a Bible? Open your Bibles this morning to the book of 3 Corinthians chapter 13. Did I get you? See, some of you going, I don't get it. I don't get the joke. Well, there isn't a third Corinthians. Well, just so you know, for those of you who think you're so smart, 2 Corinthians is 3 Corinthians. You can study that on your own. But the point being is, we don't know the word that well. And biblical illiteracy in our country is like an epidemic. We don't know the word. See, Peter, James, and John, they were brought up in the synagogue and praying three times a day and learning the word constantly, right? Always. But today in this country, I just looked up biblical illiteracy in the Barna Group 2018, had some interesting stats. Listen to this. Half of the adults in America claim to use their Bible from anywhere to once a day to once a month. Half Americans? I don't see the fruit of that, do you? 6 in 10 Americans believe the Bible has been used to change their life. 82% of Americans believe that the quote, God helps those who help themselves, is in the Bible. 82%. Oh, this is even better. And those that identify as born again Christians only did 1% better. 81% of Christians believe that. 12% of American adults believe Jonah Ark was Noah's wife. For real. For real. You know, one poll I read at a high school they did among senior graduates revealed that the majority thought Sodom and Gomorrah were a married couple in the Bible. Seriously. I mean, it's just not biblical literacy. I mean, you start asking, you know, millennials who the vice president is, and they're going to say Chuck Schumer or something. You know, they're just out of touch. Ostrich, head in the ground. We don't know and we don't care. It's just whatever works for my life, in my little narrow circle, my little tunnel vision, whatever it is. And we're ignorant of something that is so powerful. Man, knowing the word of God is spiritual warfare 101. You got to dive in and soak in this, man. The sword of the spirit, that's the word of God, right? I mean, God has given us this powerful tool, his word. It is truth, not subjective. It's objective truth. The scripture says in Hebrews 12, the word of God is living and active and full of power, making it operative, energizing, and effective. It is sharper than any two-edged sword, penetrating as far as the division of the soul and spirit, the completeness of a person, of both joints and marrow, the deepest part of our nature, exposing and judging the very thoughts and intentions of the heart. Man, the word of God cuts through all the politics, all the denominational dogma that we have. When the word of God is held up with faith, hope, and love in its context, it brings clarity. We weren't sent out to promote reveal fellowship, Calvinism, Arminianism. We weren't sent out to proclaim the gift of deliverance. We were sent out to proclaim the gospel, the truth, right? That is our agenda. The word of God is more than a book, by the way. He's a person. He's a person. And we're coming to declare him. And we do that in the face of the enemy. There's power. I mean, don't you love the accounts in the Bible says where Jesus is in the wilderness and the enemy comes at him. And each time Jesus says, it is written, right? It is written. He starts quoting the word of God. What did the enemy do with that? He fled. He's like, this isn't working out. I can't continue. And it's amazing to me that this book collects dust in our homes. We pick it up if we do. And ever since we got our electronic swords, you know, our iPhones, our Android, excuse me, don't want to offend anybody. You know, we don't need a Bible because we have it. And we'll start to read a Bible and go, oh, notification, Facebook. Wait a minute. Okay, what are they saying? So there's not real devotion to the word. I want to encourage you, actually take your Bible, carry it around with you. Walk into a restaurant, take your Bible. Oh yeah, but people won't, yeah, they'll know. They'll know that you're one of those. Far out. But the sad reality is we don't. We come and we listen to a preacher tell us what the Bible says. And preachers can be wrong. And because there's such a biblical illiteracy in the house of God, there's apostasy in the pulpit. Did you hear that? See, I'm counting on you to challenge pastors in love, in humility, with what you hear. Be a Berean. Because the enemy is attacking us, folks. We're under attack right now. The Apostle Paul said in 1 Timothy 4, the Spirit expressly says that in latter times, some will depart from the faith. Did you hear that? The Holy Spirit prophesied through the Apostle Paul to you and me today that in the last days, some will depart from not church or religious organizations, from the faith. What does that mean? I don't know, but I don't want to be part of that. Rather than argue about whether that's losing your salvation or being disqualified from ministry or whatever, I'm not going to argue with it. I'm just going to say, I don't want to be part of that. But the reality is some will, and as Paul talked about in 2 Thessalonians 2, before Jesus comes back, there's going to be a great falling away in the church. A great falling away in the church. That doesn't mean the attendance will drop. That just means those who are really saved will be far and few in between. But we'll all look the same. Kind of like sheep and goats together. They all kind of look the same from a distance, but they're not. That's the deal with church today. So he says, some will depart from the faith. Why? Giving heed to deceiving spirits and doctrines of demons. Oh. So Paul says in the last days, there's going to be doctrine, systematic theology, if you would, inside the church from the pulpit, quoted and taught and preached, that is actually from hell, but it'll all be shrouded with Bible verses, just like Satan did in the wilderness with Jesus, right? And it's all, and the objective is that there would be a falling away, a departure from the faith, because people don't know what the Bible says about the Bible. They know Bible verses that they use to support their agenda and their favorite doctrines, but they don't let the Bible interpret the Bible. Their allegiance is more to their denomination than to the deity of God in their life and in them, you see. It's concerning. And as I look at the pendulum swing with doctrines of legalism, where people are still trying to earn their salvation, or are, you know, hyper grace, which is kind of a form of Gnosticism, it's just like, it's insane. Neither one are Christianity, but the church is filled with, and there's the whole prosperity gospel, right? Which is consumer oriented, and what can you do for me, God, versus what you've already done and what you're presently doing in and through me for your glory, right? We're so lost. I think that's why the apostle said in 1 Timothy 4, oh, listen to this word. This is so important. Take heed to yourself and to the doctrine, just what you're teaching, what you're believing, a particular text, what's the context, what's the other text say about it? It should work in harmony. If you're contextualizing it, if you're making, oh, it's just cultural, it doesn't matter. Be careful. Take heed to yourself that you're not having a demonic influence with the eyes that you're looking with the word of God. Oh, man. Take heed to yourself and your doctrine. Continue in them. For in doing this, you will save both yourself and those who hear you. That's intense. Save yourself. So I get saved through going to seminary. That's how I get saved? No, it's the word saved doesn't mean like redeemed, justified, glorified. It just means kept from disqualification. Kept from being removed and useful. You can actually lose placement in the kingdom as far as being used. We read it all through the Bible. We read it through such places like 1 Corinthians 11, where they were at the table of the Lord in contempt, and some fell sick and even died because of it. They brought immorality in the church. Oh, it's okay. God loves us. He saved my spirit, and that's pure and holy and sinless. But this flesh, it's a body of death, and he separates the two, so I can live out all I want. It's okay. I'm saved by grace. It's all right. God knows I have human needs. So fornication, pornography, addiction, chemical addiction, all kinds of workaholism, all this stuff. It's okay. God understands. And anyone who's okay with that, you fall and prey to a doctrine of a demon. You're being lied to. And I'm telling you, that's what the enemy is doing right inside the church. And it's been going on for years. And this mixture of the world and the church, I mean, I saw this article this week, and some of you, if you put that up, of the Pope and the Imam, there was this document signed. There you go. This document that was signed that basically was saying the Catholic religion and Islam is saying we worship the same God. We worship the same God. I mean, I read the article for myself and looked at the document, and it's basically saying we're all going to the same place. And you've got so many people that are believing this type of thing. It's insane, right? I mean, we're really being tested. Do we really believe Jesus is the only way to the Father? It is so politically incorrect today to believe that. It's crazy. You want to get ostracized and rejected by your friends in school and work? Oh, just say Jesus is the only way. That's why they had lions eating Christians in Rome, because of the polytheist society. Yeah, there's many gods, right? And yet Christians are coming and saying, nope, just one and only one way to him. We're going to kill you. And today in America, at least at the point now, we're not losing our lives over it again yet. But man, you're sure run out of town, aren't you? We're supposed to be making disciples with the truth, the uncompromising truth of the Word of God. Anything less is not discipleship. It is not Christianity. It is a facade. It's a lie. It's a teaching of a demon. It sounds like it's full of tolerance. It's not. And it's running rampant today. I see the enemy more effective at making disciples after himself than I do Christians making disciples. I came across this article as well yesterday. Look at this. Washington District School. Where they're pushing Muslim prayers inside Seattle schools. Now, we can take out prayer out of school. We can take out the Ten Commandments. But the Muslim faith, oh no, that's different. I mean, after all, we have congressmen and senators that are Muslim. What do you think they're doing? Now, here's the thing. I'm not trying to attack Muslims. I love Muslims. I love Buddhists. I love everybody. I want them to hear the glorious gospel. But I want to be watchful and alert. What is going on in my world? And am I really walking and going and making and taking a stand for the truth in the midst of that? Or am I cowarding? Am I being like the church was in Germany, all prior to Hitler, on fire, full of the truth of the Word of God, and Hitler comes in and they just cower and do nothing? History is repeating itself. A dear friend of mine said he has a relative that was put in a federal prison recently here in South Florida. He went to ask for a Bible, and we'll give you a Bible, but you got to pay for it. But if you want a Quran, we'll give it to you for free. Blew my mind, right? And I see all this incredible, well, discipleship going on. There was a video, and some of you have seen this on social media. It's of an elementary school in Minnesota. And this is something that is going on. They call Diversity Enrichment Day. Take a look at this. Go for it. And they're saying Allah is great. That's what this woman is teaching them to chant as they bow. This is going on inside our schools. Incredible. Did you know this? I mean, because we're like the Christians in Germany, honestly. We've got our head in the dirt. And we're voting people in. See, what goes on in the government is only a reflection of what's not going on inside the church. It's the same thing. Now see, the good news is God's going to work it all out. But it's not so much about the result as it is the obedience to go and make disciples and teach all things that Christ has commanded. And he said he was the only way. Are you willing to take that stand? Because only a remnant is, and there's Christianity is dying off. It is. The great falling away is already taking place. This other article in Newsweek just this last week says genocide levels. Look at this. Reports Christianity is at risk of disappearing. Sri Lanka, you know what took place, the terrorism. And as they're doing polls and looking at churches that are closing down and the growth of Islam, this other article, again this week, Newsweek, concerning persecution in Syria. Christianity persecution, genocide is worse now than any time in history, report says. Now see, in America, we just got this, you know, we're like the boy in the plastic bubble. We really are. I know, Dave, what are you doing? This is Mother's Day. right? This is Mother's Day. What are you doing? Man, I'm trying to warn you. You know, I'm trying to be real. And I realize that, see, the thing is, I know there's people that just go, man, you're like a conspiracy theorist wacko, Dave. But you know what? They thought the same thing about Jeremiah and Isaiah and all the prophets that would come and speak something. They said the same thing. I take no joy in being a target for you who don't want to hear God. But those of you that do, I want you to be ready. As the net closes in and the heat gets turned up, I want you to know that you know that you know that you are a real disciple. Oh, the scripture says in Psalms 1, blessed is the man who walks not in the counsel of the ungodly, nor stands in the path of sinners, nor sits in the seat of the scornful, but his delight is in the law of the Lord, and in his law he meditates day and night. The promise, he shall be like a tree planted by the rivers of water that brings forth its fruit in season. What leaf also shall not wither, and whatever he does shall prosper. Incredible. That's a promise. Folks, I'm here to tell you, having gotten saved when I was 18, being filled with the Holy Spirit and loving the Word of God, after 3 decades plus, and I'm in love with Jesus, in love with him. It's kind of like we want our marriages to last the test of time because it's the greatest gospel track on planet Earth right now to look at a marriage, the two becoming one. Amazing, amazing, right? That's why there's such a demonic onslaught against the institution itself. But our Christianity, man, young believers are looking to see more gray hair in the house of God, right? See, for some of you that have gray hair, you're like, awesome, awesome, right? But rarely do you see people who have gray hair that have a fire above it. You don't see that very often. Why? The lamp's not full, man, and they're not really being disciples. We're called to go, and that's exactly what Peter did, man. He was filled with the Holy Spirit, got that power from on high, and the first thing he did was went down from the upper room. By the way, we're going to Jerusalem. We're going to Israel here in October. You can go to the upper room with us, and then you can walk down just like Peter did and go right down the southern steps where he preached the most incredible sermon. You know how much prep time Peter had for that sermon? See, he wasn't sitting up there in the upper room going, okay, where's my Strong's Concordance? Oh, man, where's the Tony Evans? I need some illustrations. I got to prepare this. What's my notes? What's my 3 points? You got to have the 3 points if it's going to be a good sermon. Right? He's not doing that. He's just sitting there wrecked in the presence of God. Just being wrecked, man. God is filling him and emptying him at the same time. And all of a sudden, something changes in Peter. He was already saved, mind you, but he was really still filled with himself quite a bit. But man, when that power from on high came down, oh, I love this verse 14 of Acts chapter 2. It says, Peter, standing up with the 11, raised his voice and said to them, men of Judah and all who dwell in Jerusalem, let this be known to you and heed my words. Man, he comes down and opens his mouth and the Holy Spirit fills it. What was the result? 3,000 souls getting saved. Who wants to preach a sermon where thousands of people get saved? Come on, right? I mean, who doesn't want to be used like that? But here's the thing. How many of us, like, we read the Bible, we study it, we say, but we don't see power like that? It's like, why? Why won't we see power moving when we speak the word of God like Jesus did, like Peter? Because it's more than just an education. You can memorize this book from Genesis to Revelation and there won't be any power unless, listen closely, there's an anointing. There's an anointing. Listen to what John said in 1 John 2. Little children, it is the last hour. And as you've heard that the Antichrist is coming, even now many Antichrists have come, by which we know that it is the last hour. They went out from us, but they were not of us. But if they had been of us, they would have continued with us. But they went out that they might be made manifest, that none of them were of us, but you, I hope that's you, have an anointing from the Holy One. You know all things. I have not written to you because you do not know the truth, but because you know it. And that no lie is in the truth. Verse 26 of 1 John 2 says, these things I have written to you concerning those who try to deceive you. But the anointing which you have received from him abides in you, and you do not need that anyone teach you. Wow. We're going to have to flesh that one out in a second. But as the same anointing teaches you concerning all things and is true, it is not a lie. And just as it is taught you, you will abide in him. Man, John is saying, if you have the Holy Spirit and he lives inside of you, he's not saying, wow, forget the fivefold ministry and the part where there's a teacher and God doesn't use people to teach. He sent his disciples out to teach. He's just saying that's not the primary source. The primary source is hearing the Holy Spirit. And you know it's the Holy Spirit when it lines up with the Word of God. Because if it doesn't line up with the Word of God, you're listening to a different spirit. You could be like Abraham and there's no scriptures at all and you're hearing God. You could be on a desert island and not know your Bible and be born again and hear God. You understand this? And that's what we're called. If we're going to go and teach people to obey the commands, we can't go as a Pharisee and just give them a bunch of rules. They got that at school their whole life. We're coming to be the embodiment of obedience and passion with God. That they're going to see that because there's an anointing we have from the Holy Spirit. And there's a freedom we have to look and walk and talk like Jesus Christ. Because that anointing comes in and it transforms the way that we think. Jesus said he was going to send us the Holy Spirit who would teach us. Right? John 14, the Holy Spirit would teach us. He's like our personal tutor that lives inside us, our GPS. He comes and he directs us. We want to have an ear to hear what the Spirit says to the church. Oh, man. And you start listening to him, all kinds of lies fall to the ground. Do you know that? You could be in the upper room and go, okay, I got saved in John 20. I got saved 40 days ago. But I'm still kind of like really insecure and being lied to. My hands still smell like fish. I think that's my identity. That's who I am. Man, when the anointing comes, it rewrites the software. All of a sudden, man, you start realizing, I died. My old life, my old circumstances don't define who I am. What Christ did defines who I am. And it's one thing to say that, or you hear me say that, but man, when the anointing comes and teaches you that, you leave the upper room and you go down with boldness with millions of people at Pentecost in Jerusalem, and you start preaching without any preparation. And you just go, God, speak through me. And my lack of education is irrelevant. That I denied you last month is irrelevant because God, I have your mercy. I have your grace. You've washed me clean. You've taken my sins as far as the east is from the west. You've removed them from me. Father, when you look at me, you don't see an abused child. You don't see a murderer. You don't see a prostitute. You don't see an addict. You see your son, Jesus. And you, all of a sudden, what happens is your mind starts getting renewed. It's incredible. I mean, who are you? That's really what you want to teach is new life, transformation, right? A gospel message that changes you. That's why the Bible says, repent and be baptized and you'll be saved. You know what the baptism is all about? It's about a celebration of not only the death of Christ, but that you died with him. The old life, you're dead. That's amazing to me. God, you mean everything that I did, you don't define me by that? And even in this body of death, Romans 7, where I do things I don't want to do and I have this battle going on and I get spiritual amnesia and forget about who I am in you, that God, your grace is sufficient and you open my eyes and you remind me, what sin? What's sin? And you're able to walk in boldness. You don't listen to lies and insecurity. See, I think God allows this incredible divine nature in this new man. The old man's dead, right? This new man lives inside this body of death. It's really a paradox how that works together. But it's such a testimony to the power of God, isn't it? How God can take sinful flesh and fill it with his divine nature and put the gospel on display. Amazing. And that's why I think we have memories of insecurities. I mean, why he'll take people like a Moses with a speech impediment and say, you're going to talk. While he'll take people like a Peter who didn't really have an education, so to speak, and say, I want to use you to really be a spearhead, the tip of the spear of the church. God just takes the weak things of our flesh and he displays his power in the midst. It's like this corrupt plastic cup of who we are in the flesh. And he puts his nature inside to shake the world up, right? It's amazing. And the more that you start really believing who you are, not based on your circumstances, but based in who God says you are, man, you start looking like Jesus. That's the gospel. It's very clear. God created you to know you, right? He created you to have a relationship with you. And then the story goes that man went his own way. God had a plan, didn't he? It was a good plan. God says, I'm going to make this a personal invitation. I'm going to come down in human flesh in the form of my son, and I'm going to pay the penalty of death, the penalty of sin, that I might have many sons, and they might come back to me. And when they come back a walking corpse. This body, it's going back where it came from, amen? It's going back to the dust. But this new life in me, that's what's supposed to go and make disciples. But it starts with me believing I am who God says I am. I have spent years and decades wrestling with God, with insecurities, with pain, with rejection from people, all listening to lies. I, like you, have this inward battle all the time of defining who I am. The enemy's always whispering. He's always pointing the finger. And every day I have to make a choice to go, man, what is going to be on display to make disciples and teach? Is it going to be me presenting the best of me I can? Or is it about me acknowledging I'm dead in Christ? You live in me. I've been crucified. I no longer live, man. Right? You believe that? And people see Jesus. And that inspires, that transforms, you see. But it comes down to your willingness to do what Peter did between point A and point B. And I'll leave you with this. From the moment he walked down from the upper room and preached that sermon, something happened. There was a transformation. There were lies that were replaced with truth. There was confidence in the flesh that was cast down. There was condemnation and shame that was cast down. There was the voice of the rooster crowing that was cast down. Man, and now I'm going to humble myself, and God, you're going to do it all. That happened. Why did God say, wait, man, God was preparing Peter for power. Do you know pain? I was just thinking, talking this about our brother before the service. Pain actually prepares us for power. Do you know that? When God allows things to be exposed in your life, man, abandonment, betrayal, abuse, sickness, a bad doctor's, for all this stuff that happens in our life that you think is just the enemy, let me tell you what, God has a purpose in it. And that pain is just paving a path for you to go, I have nothing to offer God. It's all you. It's all you, God. The reason that we wrestle with being an effective disciple is because we wrestle with self-righteousness. We think we had something to do with getting saved, and we think we have something to do with being saved. And that's a lie. It's a lie. It's a byproduct of a virus inside you and me. It's called self-righteousness. And it shows itself in symptoms of the fear of man, of pride. Somehow we think that we partnered with God in this glorious salvation. Man, did Lazarus partner with Jesus being called out of the grave? I don't think so. Did the bones in the valley of dry bones with Ezekiel, did they partner with the voice and the spirit that was moving? They know they were dead, corrupt. And all of us the same, mouths with open graves. You and I were the enemies of God when he called us. Do you know that? We were at war with God. That's why the Bible says, Jacob, I've loved, Esau, I hated. What does that even mean? First time I read that, I go, Jacob, why would you love Jacob? He was a liar, Lord. No, the point is, the order of the firstborn, I love. Outside of that, you're my enemy. Woof. So that means only if I'm in Christ and I'm loved? Yes. Yes. Do you get it? That's a hard pill to swallow, isn't it? The reason it's so hard to swallow is because what I just said exposed your faith in you and your false belief that there's something good in you besides Jesus. And there is not. There is not. Nothing. You and I, we deserve hell. That's what we do. But God, he loved us. No, he didn't love us. Everybody thinks, oh, well, God just loved us in our sin. No, what he loved was what we would be being restored after sin was paid for is what he loved. Don't think God loved you in your sin. No, he was loving what you would be when you would be redeemed. And foreknowing you, you see. Another hard pill to swallow that I'm sure I'll get emails about. Bring it. Because it's the truth. And why am I saying this? I'm going to tell you what I'm saying. Because if you can't accept that, then you'll stay in the upper room thinking you have something to do with your Christianity and thinking that your performance is based on your abilities versus his promise, his power, his presence that will never leave you. You start believing that, man, you walk in a holy boldness. And you can be a prostitute that says, man, you've washed me clean. You don't see anything that I've done, God. You don't see where I've denied you, betrayed you, been divisive in the church. You've forgiven me, God. You see yourself, I died. That's what baptism means. I'm dead. My sins are dead. They've been removed. What a joy that is, right? You start believing that, you get excited, and all of a sudden, memories of your past don't haunt you, they don't torment you, they don't discourage you and bring you down. They do the opposite. They build you and go, oh, that's not who I am. Oh, Lord, you removed that. I'm free from sin. I'm no longer a slave to sin. I'm a slave to God. I mean, you start believing that. Being a disciple, man, oh, man, you're a kid at Disney World for the first time. It's incredible, but you have to be willing to take a stand. You can't just hear this sermon. The anointing of God that lives inside you wants to teach and preach to you first. Do you hear that? Before your lips can ever be used effectively to go and preach at Pentecost and see the multitudes get saved and delivered and healed, first you need to be healed of the lies in you about you. Worship team, I want you to come up, please, because man, we need to give an offering to God right now, right? I've been praying, God, bring an experience today, right? What good is it if it's just a sermon? Bring an experience, Lord. I want to see someone, man, get on fire for God today. I speak that over this gathering right now. Someone, God is calling you to say, hey, I'm coming down from the upper room with a fire over my head. I'm going to take a stand and I'm going to believe I am who God says I am. Oh, listen closely to this word. This is for you. Matter of fact, can we do something fun? Yeah. Tony's excited. If you're wanting to experience a transformation, you're wanting lies about you to be removed. You want to experience the stains being removed and a fire in your heart and a holy boldness that has nothing to do with who you are and all to do with who he is in you. That's you. You're ready today to say the whole concept of Christian mediocrity out the door, out the door. God, I'm ready to be used like Peter. I'm ready to be used like Paul. I'm ready to be used like Mary Magdalene on the day of the resurrection. I am ready, God. Take me. Do your thing. Transform my mind. Wash my mind of every lie, every pain, every fear. I'm calling it down today. Because Lord, when you sent me, you gave me authority. You gave me power. You can't go display that authority and power in other people's lives without first doing it in your own. It starts in your own soul. If that's you today and you're going, man, I'm ready to do that today. I want you to stand to your feet. Take a stand. And more than even stand to your feet, I want you to come forward. Just come, press in. Man, I was walking. Yeah, you're going to think I'm weird, but that's nothing new. I was walking around here at 11 o'clock last night and praying and saying, Lord, I'm declaring this place holy ground. And I believe it right now. I believe it. I claim it in the name of the Lord Jesus Christ, that his presence is moving in this place with an anointing. And if your heart is to go, I'm calling down lies today, you're about to have an experience. I want you to close your eyes and I want you to just root yourself right where you're at, whether it's standing, whether you want to get on your knees and kneel and just rest and wait, because we're about to worship God. We're about to sit in our own upper room and have God touch us today. And I want you to listen to this word for you. This is your mission statement. For though we walk in the flesh, we are not carrying on our spiritual warfare according to the flesh and using the weapons of man. The weapons of our warfare are not physical. Our weapons are divinely powered for the destruction of fortresses. We are destroying sophisticated arguments and every exalted and proud thing that sets itself up against the true knowledge of God. And we are taking every thought and purpose captive to the obedience of Christ, being ready to punish every act of disobedience when your own obedience as a church is complete. Father, I want to speak your power and your authority, every son and daughter right now, that you've given them power to call down the lie of their past that's blocking the blessing of their future. Some of you right now are holding on as a means of strength to bitterness, to unforgiveness. God wants you to lay that down at the foot of the cross today. He wants you to speak a word that says, Father, forgive them, for they knew not what they were doing. There's an intimidation factor and a fear of man up here today that God wants to remove from your life. And it begins with accepting the work of the cross, that when he died for you, he washed away every stain, every sin. He sees his son, Jesus, when he looks at you. Let's worship our God.
Broken, but you see beauty. to believe that you're restoring me piece by piece. There's nothing too dirty that you can make worthy. You wash me.
Such mercy. God, forgive us for doubting that you're good. Forgive us, God, for taking our circumstances to judge whether you're good or not. God, you're good. The cross says you're good. The empty tomb says you're good. Oh, God, your presence in this room, it says you're good. Wash us, Lord. We renounce every lie that we've clung to, some in this room for decades, Lord. We've lived a lie. Thank you, God, that you chose us, Father. Before the world began, you chose us. You gifted us with the gift to turn to you, the gift of faith to believe. You have redeemed us in your Son, Jesus. You have bought us back. You were the only one who could, Jesus. You were the only one who was worthy. We declare, God, that the saints, the bride of Christ, is sealed in the Holy Spirit. God, you have guaranteed us things to come. We welcome the joy of the Lord in this place, the joy of forgiveness. God, the joy of service and the power of joy in the Holy Spirit to go and declare that we've been touched by you, Lord. We've seen you. We've heard you, God. We want to be vessels, God, that you would go and herald the good news, the gospel, Lord, to our family that's dead in their sin, to our boss who's dead in their sin. Oh, Father God, we want to speak to that valley of dry bones and say, come alive. God, you've given us authority, so we speak to our own soul today and say, be clean. Be washed clean today. Father, thank you. The old is gone. The new has come. God, we plan on walking on water today. We plan on shouting and raising a hallelujah and seeing Jericho fall today, Father God. Thank you, Father. Thank you, my God. Oh, yeah. Yeah. Oh, amen. Amen. Oh, you know, in heaven, in heaven, it says when John was there, he saw a multitude beyond counting, and they were all dressed in robes of white. Robes of white, right? It's like there's no sin. Here's the thing, he sees us like that now. You don't have to wait for heaven. Right now, as in heaven, so on earth, he sees you. Will you see what he sees? And will you speak over you what he speaks over you? And if you'll do that, you won't walk in the fear of man anymore. You'll have peace in every storm. You'll see miracles all around you. Demons will flee when you walk into a room. Father, we want to thank you, God, for all your promises that are true, and amen. We stand on them today, Father, and we welcome you, God. Baptize us afresh in your Holy Spirit. If that's you, saint of God, just raise your hands high. God, pour out your Spirit on me. Use me in these last days, God. Guard my heart. Guard my mind. May the truth of your word be declared through every breath of my life, Father God. Walk with me, Lord. In Jesus' name, and everybody shouted, amen. Amen. God bless you, family. Have a great week with Jesus.